Shall we go?
Yeah.
Watched and waited by the door of many's a village hall, to see you swirl across the floor while I stood next the wall. No good Scots grain or grenadier in courage could surpass my asking no a dance the steer whom upon he border lass. Fleet of foot, all partners part, for time is fleeter still. And through the years you dance your heart, and the lancer's Olaf's will. And the fairest flower will fade until she shuns the looking glass. But I hold the scented petals still on my bonny border lass. And I ken the warrior rest your head at the dying know the deed. In humble cot or feather bed or deep below the clay, I only know, although my dreams and vanities are past, the face that through the firelight gleams is my bonny border lass. In that bright land beyond life's shore, where time has ceased to be, and lovers share forevermore each other's company, I'll search amidst the throng for you, and when I hold you fast, then I will sing this song for you, my bonny border lass. Until that day I long for you, my bonny border lass.
Well, welcome to Sittin' In. I'm Doug Cox, and my guest today, all the way from close to Edinburgh, Scotland, is Archie Fisher. Welcome to the show, Archie.
Thanks. Nice to see you
Thanks
again.
Thanks for coming here. Nice to see
after
you,
after all
too.
These years.
So you've spent quite a bit of time touring in Canada over the years.
Since probably about 1979, when I first came over to work with Tommy Makem and Lane Clancy.
Oh, okay.
I was backlined with them for a while, and record producer. And I also toured in the 80s with Garnet Rogers quite extensively.
And most recently, you were saying you did a tour with James Keelahan.
Yeah, a couple of top men.
In Eastern Canada? Is that where that was?
Yeah, it was mainly Nova Scotia, and then we went on to Celtic Colours.
Oh, okay. So you started off, I read your bio on Wikipedia, which I'm wondering how true it is.
I daren't look.
I was reading that there was a festival in Edinburgh in about 1964 that you had played at. Was maybe your first festival or something like that?
Yeah, that was actually part of the fringe. It wasn't the official festival. And the record companies came up to try and scoop up all the folk singers that were hanging about, and they actually made an album. The recording studio was all set up, and there was a line of folk musicians outside, and they said, right, there's £5, go in and sing a song.
Oh, okay.
And that was the last we saw of any money. When my sister and I sang a song together, and they liked it so much, they said, "Will you do another one?" And my sister said, "Another £5." So that was the start of our professional recording career.
So the bands like Pentangle, it seemed like they were the ones that kind of brought folk to the newer generations. Was there stuff that was going on before that?
I think so, because a band like Pentangle, a five-piece like Pentangle, all of them were rugged individuals musically as well. There's two kinds of bands. There's a band that is made up of all people, and the sum of the total is the band. And there's the other kind of band, which is like the band itself, which has got a group of members who are all strong, but they're all compatible.
Right.
And I think Pentangle had that. They had Bert Jans, who's a Scot, and John Renburn, and Jackie, and Danny Thompson. And they also held their lineup for a long time, unlike bands like Fairport Convention, which could change the lineup, but there was still a band sound and a band dynamic that you could see the join.
Oh, okay. And you were lucky enough to, I'm sure, be in the middle of a lot of that.
In the formative years, yeah. We used to run a folk club in Edinburgh with the Incredible String Band.
Oh, okay.
Way back then. And they started off just Clive and Robin and the band, just as a duo. And they were a jug band, really. And then the psychedelic movement crept in. So that was very formative in terms of all kinds of things Edinburgh at that time, in the 60s, the early 60s.
Well, I'm fascinated by your sense of the history of folk music, because you were there for so much of what happened back in those early days, and then when it kind of started up in North America. But I also love your singing and your songwriting, so maybe we should hear another song.
As I mentioned earlier, I toured with Garnet Rogers in the 80s, and we came back together again for a short American tour in 2012. And I thought, just as a little compliment, I'd write him a song. Oh, I never told him, but but he played on it. And it's a kind of response song. I'll sing a line and then I'll play a guitar lick exactly the same, and I'm sure you'll pick it up. Just once in a while, you're there on my mind. You bring me a smile and leave it behind. I honor your name, remember your face. You're ever the same in time and in space. Doors open and close, roads run to an end. So I will compose a song for a friend. When years roll away, fond memories shine. A warm summer's day, a cool glass of wine, and the line of a song forgotten in time. If I get it wrong, you'll give me the rhyme. Whatever you play, whatever the key, whatever you say, it's all right with me. If you have a dream, I hope it comes true. As part of the scheme that's waiting for you. And if you have a fear kept hidden within, remember I'm here, together we'll win. Stay lucky in love, it's what you deserve. When push comes to shove, hold on to your nerve. Don't worry if you've forgotten to phone. When you're in the groove, you're running alone. And though we're far apart, I know you're at hand. We're joined at the heart, and I understand. And the next time around, we'll do it in style. Go painting the town, me, you, and your smile.
So you wrote that for Garnet?
Yeah.
Nice. And you had two of your songs recorded by Stan Rogers as well, right? Or were there more than two that he did?
There was two he actually got onto record. There was another couple that he was going to record. And I think I have the distinction, and I'm very proud of the fact, and humbled by the fact, that there were probably the only two other singer-songwriters
material that he'd ever recorded. He didn't really record any other singer-songwriter's material. There was The Witch of the Westmoreland and Dark Eyed Molly.
Right, and that must have been your introduction to a lot of Canadians. It certainly was for me. I remember Witch of the Westmoreland was the first time that...
It's a very strange ballad, that, because three novels have been written about it.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
And people sort of extemporized what they thought it was all about and read all kinds of mystical things into it. It's a slightly allegorical thing about a girlfriend I had in the Lake District, that's all.
Oh, okay.
But there is a sequel. That I wrote for the Stan Rogers Festival a few years ago, Stanfest in Cancel.
Okay.
It's called The Return. And that's going to be on the new album, which working on at the moment.
And is that coming out sometime soon?
Well, I'm halfway through it with Red House Records, and hopefully it'll come out in the fall. You're a guitar man. You know all about all kinds of guitars. And one of my first loves as a guitar was an old 1930s Gibson Kalamazoo.
Oh, nice.
And still up in the attic. And recently when I sort of looked it out, there was a set underneath it that I was doing back in the late 60s and early 70s. And it was just astonishing. I couldn't remember any of them, apart from Kumbaya. Mm-hmm. But there was also this little song that obviously started off in Appalachia, but was collected in Newfoundland. Fare thee well, my own true love, fare thee well, my dear. The ship is a-waiting and the wind blows high, and I am bound away for the sea. Ten thousand miles away from home, 10,000 miles or more, the seas will freeze, the earth will burn, if I never more return to you, Mary Ann. The crow that is so black, my love, will change its color white, if ever I prove false to you. The day will turn to night, my dear baby. And can't you see that lonesome dove that flies from pine to pine? He's mourning for his own true love, as I do now for you, my dear. Where my breasts were made of glass, wherein you might behold the secrets of my own true love, in letters written gold, my dear baby. There's a lobster boiling in the pot, a blue fish on the hook, they're suffering long, but it's nothing like the ache I bear for you, my dear. And had I bought a flask of gin and sugar here for two, and a great big jar for to mix it in, I'd pour a drink for you. So fare thee well, my own true love, fare thee well, my dear. The ship is a-waiting and the wind blows high, I am bound away for the sea, baby.
Beautiful. What was that one called?
It's called Mary Ann.
Oh, okay. Lovely. So let's talk about your tunings a little bit for the guitar players out there, because I know we have lots of guitar players. And
okay.
It seems like that the sort of the origins of what we now think of as the open tuning world sort of started over over in Scotland and England, maybe with folks like Davy Graham. Is that
Davy
is that
Graham
right?
Was the first person I saw using, you call it Dag Dad or Dad Gad, which
Dad Gad,
Dad Gad, and I borrowed it immediately from him because he was a sort of brother-in-law at the time.
Oh, okay.
And I was known as the Thief of Dagbad. But anyway, he used it for Indian tunes and for Arabic tunes.
Oh, okay. And so did you start off by learning some Indian scales and some Arabic scales?
Or? I went to India in the 60s, 1965, 66. I was working as a photographer, wildlife photographer, and I got a sitar and studied in Mumbai, as it is now, Bombay, for about 2 months with a sitari, and brought the sitar home and discovered that the Beatles were using one.
Oh, okay.
So I'd been gazumped. And then when I met up with Davy intermittently over the years, he's a fantastic guitarist. I mean, in conventional tuning, he was a fantastic jazz guitarist. But he really opened up that, the idea of Dag Dad is you have resonating strings, there's no third in it. And it's very similar to drones in pipes and other droned instruments. And it also frees up the left hand to play cadences of chords rather than barre chords, because you're just playing two string chords all the time. But you can also play an A, and of course an A minor as well, and C as well. And the other tuning you use is open G, which is Sebastopol tuning. But you can drop the C, the D, down to C and that, and actually play in C as well. It gives that a very nice deep resonance.
Oh, okay.
But Hawaiian guitarists use different tunings as well.
Sure.
So it was basically from the when Celtic music came in that had these kind of chords. The open tuning, D tuning, became very popular.
Oh, okay. So you're getting ready for another song, and this is Dad Gad tuning with a capo on, basically.
I know that Cumberland is an old mining town.
Yes,
in fact, it was a mining city almost at one time.
Yeah.
Three of my sisters married northeastern Geordies, Newcastle area people. So I'm entitled to sing Geordie songs. I've got a passport for that.
Okay.
There's a lad called Ed Pickford who's the kind of bard of the Durham coal mine area. This is one of Ed's songs. The stream was black from a miner's back in the place where I spent childhood days. I built a camp in the pit prop yard. I remember the mines had ladies' names. From the swings you could see the men on haunches as they crouched in line. That was then, but now I think, what a strange lover is a coal mine. A strange lover that'll kill a brother, crucify a wife and mother, sleep with a man while she plans to bring him down. But a strange lover is a coal mine. My friend Joe worked for 50 years deep in the belly of a Durham mine. And in all these years he shed no tears. Durham lads are not that kind. Brother died in a fall of stones, and he seemed like a hero at the time. That was then, but now I think, what a strange lover is a coal mine. A strange lover that'll kill a brother, crucify a wife and mother, sleep with a man while she plans to bring him down. What a strange lover is a coal mine. My friend Joe lived till he grew old, but he never forgot the Durham mines. He loved the coal and the union too, he'd a miner's pride in his own time. I remember the hot Julys when the banners flew in the Durham skies. I remember the hopes, the fears and the lies. But a strange lover is a coal mine. A strange lover that'll kill a brother, crucify a wife and mother, sleep with a man because he plans to bring him down. But a strange lover is a coal mine. And the stream was black from a miner's back at the place where I spent childhood days. Ed Pickford.
Nice. It's a good Cumberland song, too.
Yeah.
So do you see the role of a singer-songwriter? I mean, I guess traditionally the role of a folk singer was to go around and spread the news and bring up issues and stuff. Do you see that changing in the modern world with the internet and all that kind of stuff?
I think that there was the era, you know, the Dylan era of the protest song. And the protest song still has a place. And I think that was the most important thing that the folk revival did. Gave a voice to minorities, but it also released a whole set of poets, like mm-hmm. Dylan. It was a very accessible kind of music for the audience as well. There was no great proscenium arch scenarios about it. And most folk clubs are just an intimate interchange between two people, you know, the audience sitting there, and there's no great pretense about it. And most of the singers I know and the songwriters I know that have got something to say are very modest. You know, there's no showing off about what they do. It's just they feel as if they're a vehicle for what they're doing. And the singer-songwriter is a continuum of the folk singer.
Do you think that the younger singer-songwriters that you see are still following that tradition?
Young singer-songwriters have to get one thing out of the system. When you start writing songs and when you start doing an album, it's going to be the accumulation of all of your emotions and experiences up to that time. So you have to go through a door with that. And a lot of that is very personal. So, you know, there's millions of songs out there. Why do we need new ones? And we need new ones because new people are going to perform them.
Sure, yeah. And the people that do perform them need to make money as well. And that's...
Well,
it must be hard to make money not playing your own songs all the time.
It's a craft and a trade as well. Yeah. Yeah, it's got to be both.
You wrote a beautiful song called Ontario Dust. Would you play that for us? And I'm assuming you wrote this when you went home from a tour in Canada. Is that true?
Yeah. As I mentioned, I ride Western. Right, I've got an American quarter horse. I had two. I had an old mare that lasted until 32. She was great. She was called Tequila Sunrise. And the new young fellow's called Montana Moonshine. So you see a pattern of it.
Oh, yeah.
And Jim McKay from Brantford, Ontario, comes over and teaches us how to be cowboys. He trains cutting horses. And I worked with him for a few days in Brantford and had a great time. Went back to his place at the end of the dusty day, and he collects single malt whiskies. So, not for very long.
Nice.
But so this is for Jim. In the grey of the gloaming, a fool beam my lights as the borderland settles to a long winter's night. There's a glitter of frost and a crunch to my wheels as I turn on the back road for home. And the old dog that welcomes me whines by the door. There's a stack of brown envelopes strewn on the floor. And the stone cottage echoes to the click of my heels, and the message light blinks on the phone. And the last mile I traveled to this journey's end was crowded with the faces and the voices of friends. There were bronc and bull riders at rodeo shoots, and I've still got Ontario dust on my boots. And I empty my suitcase by the washing machine with the traces of places that show where I've been. It's too late for coffee, but I pour out the grounds and sit down by a cold, empty fire. I can hear in the distance the surf of the road with the swish of the tires and the rumbling load as the sweet silvery waters of the Gallarhorn down, and a half-empty moon's climbing higher. And I'm 6 hours ahead of Canadian time, but my pockets still jingle with loonies and dimes. I'm back in my homeland, disturbing my roots, but I've still got Ontario dust on my boots. Now it's not in the journey where you arrive, it's the place that you're leaving, and if you can survive all the good times and bad times you'll find in despair when you're lonesome and lost in a song. And away to the north of the lake Erie shore is a box of crisp apples by an old farmhouse door. And wood smoke and coffee are sweet on the air, and the radio's rambling along. And the creak of old leather's been whispering to me what I'd like to wear and where I'd like to be. I'd rather have Wranglers than Armani suits, and a layer of Ontario dust on my boots. Now there is no forever or never again. There's a here and a there, there's a now and a then. And we all take our turn of the moon and the sun and the stars as the world rolls around. On a bright winter's morning, I walk in the field with a horse at my shoulder and a dog at my heel. And I pull down my cap brim to hide from the sun that's melting the frost on the ground. Still feel the stirrups and the slack in the rein as the cutting horse rolls back and tosses her mane. But the clear border dew on the green grassy shoots has washed the Ontario dust from my boots.
Thank you. Beautiful. It's nice to hear a Canadian song written by a non-Canadian like that every
good. Yeah.
I guess you'll take us out with the song.
This is a song and an invitation.
Okay.
When these shoes were new, it was how do you do? It was whiskey and telling our tales. And when this shirt was clean, I was there to be seen. I had clear eyes and my smile never failed. And all of the brothers that I met on the way, they were drinking by night, they were drinking by day. Restored to my eyes what was clear and was bright. Come and take me out drinking tonight. Come and take me out drinking tonight. Bells and matches and cards on the table, the sweet smell of the luscious woodbine. Mr. McEwen, you will be my ruin. I say it, but I really don't mind. And all of the sisters that I met on the way, they were drinking by night, they were drinking by day. Restore to my eyes what was clear and was bright. Come and take me out drinking tonight. Come and take me out drinking tonight. And Michael and I watched the summers go by, and we sang for the friends that we'd known. Gargle in jars in old Dundee bars, but he's left me here drinking alone. And all of the lovers that we met on the way, they were drinking by night, they were drinking by day. Restore to my eyes what was clear and was bright. Come and take me out drinking tonight.